This is a great honor to be here at one of the most...
Is there a cushion?
What part of my body? Yeah, sure. Yeah, go ahead. That's great. One of the great sacred places of the world, yet to be fully discovered, or else we wouldn't have room in this hall, but a remarkable place, and those of us who get to visit not only partake of the atmosphere, but know how hard everyone's worked to keep this place together and to make it as beautiful as it is. I want to thank in advance all the folks who've been part of this spring Sahabas, the graciousness of everyone, the friendliness of everyone, and the help everyone's given me. It's part of your spirit here. Now, tonight, and I greet old friends and new friends, Bill and Diana from way back, and Jim just tells me I had been in Detroit several decades ago. We're not being recorded, are we? This is the best. People usually record these things. And you can't tell them the juicy secrets. It comes back to haunt one later. So, tonight's informal. And although one has a responsibility of weaving in stuff so it'll fit for the rest of the weekend. So I'm going to tell you something about the crazy 60s and what was happening with me and some other folks who were going to become Baba lovers before it happened, before we found out, and what coincidences were going to be set up to make that which came later fit into Baba's plans. So if you can imagine, the first part starts at Harvard University, at a dining hall. I and some friends and students are eating, and a young stranger that we hadn't seen before in the hall sat in our table, and we were discussing, this was early in the year, what courses we were going to take. And the discussion got around to some of the psychology courses, and somebody said, well, I heard that this course on motivation was really easy. It's being taught by a new guy. I said, well, that sounds interesting. Who's the new guy? And the stranger said, I'm the new guy. It was Dick Alpert, Richard Alpert, who had been a hot professor, very behaviorally oriented, from Stanford. And someone he was to meet soon, named Timothy Leary, joined the Harvard faculty. I was very embarrassed, but I did take his course. And later, I finished undergraduate, and I was going to graduate school in psychology. And every possible force and advice that the faculty gave was, don't stay at Harvard. You got to broaden your exposure to professors. Go someplace else. But, as karma would have it, I finally found a cheap apartment. And you know how that is? You don't want to give it up. So I said, no, I'm going to stay. They said, don't, you don't chance. And I refused. And to the betterment of their judgment, I stayed around. Well, interesting things happened. This was 1961, and the academic year of 1962. During that summer, Timothy Leary had gone down to Mexico and had gotten a breakfast omelet full of psilocybin mushrooms, which contained psilocybin, which is a hallucinogenic drug. It blew his mind. He came back, he told Albert, and they started ordering psilocybin, its pure form, from the Sandoz company. as an investigational drug. And then, later in the semester, they said to the graduate students, they were doing our clinical kind of field work training, you had a choice. You can take the final exam, or you can participate in this experiment and write it up. What do you think we chose? As we did. So, they gave us psilocybin, and we were going to write it up. And obviously, this, especially in those days, the kind of hallucinogenic experience was different from anything we had experienced and even knew about. And it seemed terrific, except for the students who had really bad trips. And it didn't seem so terrific to them. But that started a whole group of graduate students, myself included, who became the psychedelic vanguard. We had discovered a new form of consciousness expansion, ladies and gentlemen. Never before done. Knew nothing, nothing about Eastern spirituality. Nothing. Knew very little about God. And not much, and certainly nothing yet about Meir Baba. Two of my friends, whose names you might know, Rick Chapman and Robert Davis, were also in Boston at that time. And the circle was close enough so that everybody pretty much knew everybody. Well, we started the experiments. It got a little controversial. I stuck with them. LSD was introduced. It began to roll. And we did some experiments like taking psilocybin out to the nearest prison and turning on the convicts.
Oh, God.
Yes. Some said they would change their lives. Others stole our tape recorder. But that was part of the game. That morphed into a very, very interesting next summer, where Tim Leary had rented a beach hotel. Beach hotel, it's a motel. Well, take Motel 6 and divide it by 7. And gathered the graduate students and others who were interested in this to do intense exploration for the summer and develop a new model, partially based on the Tibetan Book of the Dead. And the notion was that you could transcend your ego by taking these drugs. That the Tibetan Book of the Dead was a metaphor for the transformation of the ego. As it turns out, it's a book for people who are dying. But hey, we did not care. And we started to attract some of the kind of cultural elite, some of the rich Park Avenue people, some creative people. And I was invited to come down for the summer by Dick Alpert, and he invited me to fly with him in his private plane. This turned out to be an adventure in which I could easily have been eliminated from the earth. And never knew at that time why I was safe. Anyway, I knew that was happening, so I whipped out and I did the first part of a pilot training, just in case. He might get a heart attack, who knows, you know. And it turned out we got to Mexico City, and after we left Mexico City to try to find the now not so sleepy fishing village of Zihuatanejo near Ixtapa, as soon as we got out of Mexico City, which is ringed by mountains, very high mountains, over a plateau, and we had to cross the Sierra to get to the coast, it turned out, much to our non-knowledge at the point, that a piston blew in the plane. All we knew is it didn't climb very well. And so we could only get about 7,000 or 8,000 feet up, facing 10,000 feet mountains. There was no radio at that time. There was no navigational aids. And of course, we got lost immediately. We knew the ocean was that way, and that was it. And we decided to try to fly the valleys and see if there was a ridge we could sneak over to make it to the ocean. And we survived many of those valleys, and then the final valley came. And there was this ridge line of trees, and we were headed right for it. And it was clear that if the wind was coming from the ocean, we created downdraft, we would crash into the mountain. That's the usual wind pattern. If there were no wind, it was 50-50. If the wind was going the other way, we might pop over. And I remember thinking, this is like a B-movie. If we do not crash, this will be a great story. And there were people for hundreds of miles, so it was all or nothing. We made it clearly over to the and found the ocean. And said, should we turn left or right? But we turned left. We found the town. And we found the motel. And so we buzzed it on the beach. People waving, etc. And then the engine started to cough again. And I said to Albert, I think we should go to the airport now. Okay. So we are flying in. The airport is set into a mountain valley. And you have to really land against the wind. So we had to fly into that valley trying to turn around. And it seemed very difficult to turn around. And I said to Albert, how are we going to turn around? And then suddenly the engine quit entirely. And I said to him, I think we should turn now. The plane, he was a skilled pilot, fortunately. The plane landed about two-thirds of the way down the runway. And almost rolled over a cliff of like 200 feet down to the rocks in the ocean. And then later we found out that a piston had blown. That was just the start of the summer. Now, funny things happened with the Tibetan Book of the Dead in Zihuatanejo. One of the ones that perhaps gave us a clue. There are two things that happened. One, there was this scientist who came down to take LSD under supervised conditions. And he took the LSD, and then he disappeared. We could not find him. We couldn't find him. And we learned that he was very high security. CIA was very interested in him. And later said to everybody, after we searched the village, we searched everywhere, we could not find the guy. He decided, we should say, we never saw him. He was found. He was found in Mexico City, going from door to door, store to store, banging on the store, looking in, looking at the shopkeeper and saying, 2 + 2 = 4, that's it. Very, very profound. I admit, let's get back to the States. Then, and could have been the start of the tip-off. Then, for some reason, Tim Leary, who was interested in baseball, challenged the local Mexican team to a game. They were in a professional league. We were all stoned out of our minds. We said, Tim, you what? You what? Yeah, so a big sign went up in the village square. Universidad de Harvard versus Zihuatanejo. Now, I know in Australia you might not have a full knowledge of baseball. Think cricket, primarily. And anyway, we were forced to borrow everything. And so the slightly impaired Harvard graduate students took on the Zihuatanejo team. And the people from Zihuatanejo were very, 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 very interested in all of this. And stands were filled. They moved the cows out of the outfield a little bit. And it was kind of insane. And happily for everyone, there, the Ziwatanejo team was far ahead of us near the end of the game. But then something happened. And I guess from cricket analogy, that we were hitting the bowler, baseball, the pitcher. And the game was tied the very, very last inning. And the crowd was getting very restive, extremely restive, because how could these people possibly come closer? And I was getting worried. And I thought, we should lose. It would be a good thing. It would be a very good thing. Game ended and this was to be an omen. The game ended with our side almost winning, but there was a ball hit in the air. And the same as in cricket, if you catch it, the person is out. And I was next to the fellow where the ball was coming to. In the air, he looks at me and he says, "Which ball should I catch?" He was so hallucinating. He was so hallucinating. And I said, "Well, catch the one in the middle." Thank God he did, and the real ball hit him in the head. As you watch the new team one. That was the kind of summer it was. But Leary then said, we have to write a Bible of this, and started a new organization called the International Federation of Internal Freedom. If. A little shaky organization. So we came back to Harvard, and Leary and Albert got in trouble for giving LSD to students when it wasn't approved. And I would say maybe a third of the class, myself included, were still gung-ho. At that time, as Roy reminded me, these substances were investigational drugs and not totally illegal, although the way we were using them were pretty illegal. Because we were involved in this kind of very far-out stuff at a very traditional institution, we got very interesting visitors from authors like Aldous Huxley to jazz people like Charles Mingus, these are the old days, to movie director celebrities. And several of us were being trained to be psychedelic gurus. Yes. Yes, certified to take you on a trip. We would script out the first 5 hours with your favorite texts and movies and music. Just so you'd have a good experience. Now, even then, we began to understand that you didn't want to take these drugs in a bad mood. You did not want to do that. Because basically, they heightened the state of consciousness one was in. So there's nothing like hallucinogenic-generated paranoia. Nothing like it. That's great paranoia. It's the ultimate paranoia. So we had this, and we also then started to meet folks who were also interested in higher consciousness and just a little bit of a touch of the East and the West. We met a grandmotherly figure who was one of Boston's great clairvoyants and known as a healer, and had written many books on astrology. This is very, very kind. And she adopted a lot of the graduate students who didn't eat too well. And so after a while then, I kind of grew up in a situation where none of these really wild things were questioned. For example, so my car radio went out, and I took one of these portable radios, and I took it to this lady, her name was Frances, Yeah, Pastor. I said, Francis, what's wrong with this radio? She says, I don't know anything about radio. He's like, put your hands on it and tell me what's wrong. The chances, I don't know. But whatever the problem is, it's right here. Open it up, the batteries were in the wrong position. I told this to a few of the folks at dinner the other night, but Robert Dreyfuss then and I were getting to be very friendly. Robert had always had a little asthma trouble, and I had wanted him to bring him to Francis to get some healing. But Robert was skeptical about all of this. This is a little pre-Baba. So I said, Robert, come on. I'm going to get a massage kind of healing thing. Why'd you sit in? I thought you'd be comfortable, you know. So she was in the middle of working on my back, and suddenly her head jerked like that. And she looked up, she says, cut that out. And I ignored that. And then about 3 or 4 minutes later, it happened again. Her head jerked, and she said, stop that. And now I'm getting worried. Robert's eyes are getting very wide at this point. So I had an idea what was going on. It happened a third time, and I said, okay. Princess, what is going on? She says, it's the damn medical school class on the other side. It was a medical school class in the astral world, who's kind of probably studying for her next life, and there were three medical professors wanting them to do something on my back. They were experimenting. And she said, you know, they're just like physicians, they're obnoxious. And no patience at all. And she said to them, would you allow me to do what they want me to do with your back? This is a heavy choice. I don't think I really did. But on the other hand, why be a spoil sport for the other side? And I said, yeah, are they competent? And Prince said, yes, they're obnoxious, but they're competent. So apparently what happens is she does her thing, and a distinct, almost magic marker-like red line appears on my back. And I said, what red line? I can't see it. Robert comes over, leaps on this. Hey, A-Stack, to be my nickname. He says, it's there. Somebody drew a line down your spine. For instance, well, they wanted to highlight that because that's where they were working. Well, she didn't have a magic marker in her hand. Later, all these things will work in to later things that happen with Baba. And in her case, and I'll talk a little bit more about the implications of this tomorrow. After we had known about Baba and what Baba had said about drugs, we took Francis the Clairvoyant down to a 3,000-acre estate where the group was hanging out in about 100 miles out from New York City, that had been donated by very wealthy and eccentric bankers. It was a 60-room house with a army tank on the front lawn. It was a little peculiar. And so we brought her down to look at auras and kind of look at the, see what was going on. And we drove her back. And he said, what did you see? She says, whoa. She said, there's a big astral octopus looking thing that's sucking the energy from the people in the house. And she named a couple of people. One of them, the guy was sleeping 18 hours a day, I swear. That's all. And then she said, and your pet armadillo knows it's there. We have an armadillo. Is that an Australian animal?
No.
No, it's not. It's like a platypus with spines. Anyway.
It's
there was a zoo nearby, and the little armadillo would snap at the tentacles of this astral entity. We thought it was a very neurotic armadillo, although what kind of therapy can you do with a neurotic? So we began to then, later, we would get a sense of why Baba was so concerned about all of this. As time went on, people would come to what we call it Millbrook, the IFIF headquarters. I was doing an internship for a 5,000-bed school for the mentally retired, which was only 10 miles away. And so yoga people would come. There was one guy who was a master hypnotist who had been hired by the CIA to kill Castro mentally.
That's gonna work out.
I was on watch. I was on watch one day, and I saw a big black limousine pull up, and a guy in a black suit going out, and another man in a robe, big, bald, looked Asian, and I had a chill of fear through me. I didn't know why, because it turns out there was an original movie called The Manchurian Candidate. Yeah. And he played the evil hypnotist in the original. His name was Kai D. He eventually became Lofat on a series that ran in America called Hawaii Five-O. Mm-hmm. And he was there to discuss a book he had written about the Tao Te Ching. These kind of people would come. Another time, it was early in the morning, and I heard something outside, and I looked outside, and I saw a gigantic bus painted in all kinds of psychedelic colors with a kind of a machine gun turret up the top, and people filing out. I went back to sleep figuring it was an ordinary flashback, but it continued, and it turned out the person named Ken Kesey and his magic bus of the recreational side of the LSD movement, which we did not approve of. No, we were academics. So it was a tense visit. And at the end of the day, one of the Ken Kesey people abandoned them and joined our group.
Oh,
but one of our group said they're having more fun. So there began to be some a few cracks in the vision of transcendent at Milbury. Another time, and again, this is a theme that will come up in Mayor Baba's work time and time again. There were a couple of nights when they both took LSD and transcended their egos completely. And in the morning, there was a big fight over whose turn it was to do the dishes. And I'm saying to myself, now something's not fitting here. Something is not fitting. that time, we also started, you know, there was a, that somehow, you know, you got high and you transcended your ego and you might have had a God experience, but it was A, difficult to replicate every time, and B, you came down. Now, Albert said, I am going to see if it's possible to stay high for weeks. And he boarded himself in a cabin with a huge, huge amount of LSD to see how long he would last. And it was 3 days, basically. And he just reached tolerance, and he couldn't sustain it. So the group, and this is also true for Rick and Robert, we started to explore other techniques. One of them was based on the work of George Gurdjieff, who was an authentic teacher and mystic in East Europe and Asia. Drew a lot of intellectuals. And we heard We heard a rumor that he didn't like much drugs for consciousness expansion. So we invited the teacher, the Gurdjieff teacher in America, who was running their New York group, up to Millbrook for a debate with Timothy Leary. The Gurdjieffians versus if. The debate lasted 3 minutes. After 3 minutes, it was clear that this Gurdjieff guy knew so much more than Leary, who would take the position after he knew what Mayor Bottle said. He took the position that he was the wisest man in the world. That's tough to sustain. And backed him really into a corner. And the difference between he and Richard Alpert, who eventually became Baba Ram Dass, was Alpert's willingness not to think he was the wisest man in the world. I will go forward a little bit here. Can extend one of the links. So Alpert eventually goes on a spiritual search, spiritual path, goes to India, and finds a guru named Neem Karoli Baba, called him Maharaji. And one of the great stories of the genre, which you will appreciate more when I tell you, the kicker, was when Alpert came to had an interview with the guru. And the guru says, "I am understanding you have this LSD thing that you work with." Yes, sir. He says, "Do you have any on you?" And Alpert says, "Yes." And the guru says, "Could I see, please?" Takes out about 1,000 doses of LSD. You know, it's very, very. 200 millionths of a gram will send you bye-bye. Mm-hmm. Not bye-bye dead, bye-bye in your mind. You know, the guru kind of looked at it, and then he opened the vial and drank it all. I was, oh my God, I just killed my guru. Oh my God. And he goes, no, not to worry, just wait here. And he said it was agonizing, 30, 40 minutes, because that would be the time when it would really start taking effect. Nothing happened at all. It was very impressive. Now, later on, they were having a discussion, Alpert and Maharaji, and the guru says to him, "You know, Meher Baba is your real guru." And I was, "What? What'd you say? What? What?" He wouldn't repeat himself. So Alpert, who had known of Baba through Rick and Robert and I, and kind of knew what Baba felt about drugs, he wrote to Baba, and this was in, it was the late 60s, and Baba was in seclusion, but wrote back and said he was very pleased, and Baba said to Albert, "You can take LSD 3 more times, but after that you must stop." And to send Baba's love to his guru. So they were in cahoots. And later, Ram Dass really became very, very dedicated in spiritual path, and it's been very helpful. And one of his booking agents was a Baba lover from New Jersey. So all of that kind of twisted in. Leary got married, I think for the third time, when I was there, to the Eric Cigar Girl. This is the kind I would, this story I'm glad it's not being recorded here. And who was a model who had come down to Millbrook interested in esoteric things. The marriage lasted 13 days. They started taking LSD together in their honeymoon place in Nepal. It wasn't working. it wasn't working at all. So they flew in Albert to Nepal to run a session to, you know, fix the relationship. Unfortunately, the woman fell in love with Albert during the session. Doctor, complicated. That woman remarried, had a child. The child's name was Uma Thurman.
Oh.
Yeah.
And she married a very, very famous Buddhist scholar. To this day runs retreats out of New York City in a very distinguished group. There were there was another potential disaster for my career at that point at Millbrook. The Drug Enforcement Administration and the local sheriff's office got wind of strange things happening at this estate, and they organized a raid. Now, the house was set back from about a mile from a gatehouse where people lived, so the sheriff thought they couldn't get in that way because we would be warned. So they, believe it or not, got together a horseback posse to come in the back way. Together. Somehow, Baba got them lost. They could never find the property. And later, I had done some work for the DEA, and my project manager said, you know, we got a file on you. What? Come on, me? He says, the note said you used to give drugs away, you would never take money for them. I know nothing. about this. So, meanwhile, both Tom Riley and Robert Dreyfuss had gone to India, and the first few hints of Mayor Bala's position on this was given, and this little snippets in Lord Mayor. We knew that was coming. So, Leary, as some of you know, continuing to be the wisest man in the world, got in a lot of trouble with authorities, was famous for the notion of tuning in, turning on, and dropping out. Mm-hmm. Very countercultural. And that ride had a major kind of cultural influence that worked then into the USA's Vietnam War, which was even a more tumultuous time. Tomorrow I'm going to talk a little bit about Mayor Bala's views on drugs and why he felt it so important. But nonetheless, I will tell you the secret of how the Millbrook community really broke up. It had to do with Bertha the maid. Yes. We had a 17-year-old maid from Louisiana who took care of the house. She one night, she was very spunky, said to the senior people there, I want to take LSD too. Everybody's taking LSD. I'm not taking LSD. I thought you believed in equality. And senior people are saying, we don't think it's such a good idea. But intuitively we knew that. But we didn't have the ideology to suggest that we could reach it. So we did give her LSD. And the tragic aftermath was she announced, I don't want to be the maid anymore. And suddenly the house began to get in shambles. physically. And then more and more people started saying, we're not getting there wherever there is. It's not happening. So there was a lot of data already from that period. Let's see. Let me segue into maybe a more informal discussion with all of you. So one day, I was destined in order to take my ultimate psychedelic guru certification test. Now, you know how they did that. They give you a large dose of LSD and put you in a cabin alone and see if you can survive mentally for 12 hours. And if you can, then you get certified. So I'm in this cabin. At one point, at one very strange point, I was, I think, making notes that made no sense whatsoever. Not. But then something took hold of my hand. In big letters on the page, I'm still high, the way for you is love, trust, and unity. Now, what does that mean? Anyway, I passed. I was up all night, it was stoned. And then Albert says, you know, we've just been invited to Woodstock, New York, to see films of an Indian holy man. And they've been invited by the then inventors of light shows, very hip people. So it was a hip invitation. So the community was invited. I was really tired and out of it, but I didn't want to be alone again, so I'll go, yeah. So we go to Woodstock, New York. We go out on the estate with a kind of a refurbished stable. And who is there? Well, Lynn and Phyllis Ott, Fred and Ella Winterfeld, Darwin Shaw, Tom and Yvonne Riley, all of these were staunch members of the Mayor Bobby group. And it started with a brief introduction, and then they showed the film of the 62 Darshan in India. And then Darwin Shaw got up to talk about Baba. He was introduced to us as a traffic engineer from Schenectady, New York, and one of the senior elders of his Protestant church. He was dressed in an actual coat and tie, plaid even, and we were saying, we're going, oh my God, no, painful. So Darwin starts talking about Baba, and I'm not sure we listened very carefully, but it was very mysterious. Friends looked, is he on acid? You know, because he was vibing. You know, you could see, you could kind of feel the vibration. And though the content at that point, I don't think we really understood much of it, that his nature was, there was something magnetic. And Leary went over and then talked to him. Meanwhile, I kind of walked around, and they had a book table of Baba materials, and I picked up one of the books. It was called Sparks. It's a little booklet that takes snippets of Baba's sayings. I looked through it and think, hey, what is this? What is this? This guy, in a couple paragraphs, is summing up all of our reading. Buddhism, like Hinduism, everything. Who's this? Who's it? That was the guy in the film? Wow. So in the spirit of the day, I stole that book. Still paying for that one.
It's too good.
We went back and went back and said to the group, does anybody know about any other thing this guy's written? And our community techie at that time said, yeah, I do. What? Well, it turns out he was raised by a foster mother who was a Bible lover and gave him as a high school graduation gift full copy of the Discourses at that time. He said, I've never read it, but I kept it, you know? And so I got hold of the Discourses. And it's getting even better. It's getting good. But Mirabella had to pass the test. So I took some LSD, took the Discourses with me in the summer, went up on a hill overlooking Dover, and started reading. And what I got fixated on was a little piece called The Journey of the Soul to the Oversoul, which is kind of like the Discourses version of A Mini God Speaks. And when I got to the explanation of the sixth plane of consciousness, I said, that's it. I can see it. I can see it. I've hit the sixth plane here in this experience. And this is fantastic. So I'm walking down the hill. And that weekend, we were hosting a team of gypsy mimes from a New York theater group. And I'm walking down the hill, and suddenly I hear them shouting, look, 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 he's a god. He's shining, he's radiant. I said, of course. I didn't pay much attention to it. And then I was the weekend. Then on Monday, I still had my internship at the School for the Mentally Retarded, which was hell. It was called then. And so I get out of my car into the parking lot, and I start walking to my office where, and you had to walk between the dorms of the kids. And a couple of the kids stuck their heads out, and they started to applaud. And then more kids came out. And the dorms were then lined with these kids cheering me as I walked to my office. And I said, they may be retarded, but they know spirituality. So now I'm feeling guilty that these, I met all these Bible lovers, they didn't know how to get to the sixth plane. So I wrote to Kitty, David.
Oh, no.
And I said, look, I don't want to be selfish about this. Anybody can do it. And get a list of the dosage, the timings, what part of the Discourses to read. And that she was free to share this information among all the Bible lovers. The reason was I had one pamphlet that gave a post office box, 8487 or something like that, in Myrtle Beach, and Kitty Davies' name was on it. So Kitty apparently gets the letter, this I find out afterwards, and doesn't really know how to answer it. I think she intuitively knew it was really not the way, but on the other hand, it was well written. Saying, you know, some of us, this is how we got to know Mirabella, etc. So she sent it on to Adi Arai. Adi Arai at that time was the primary Western communicator with the West. And Kitty said, well, Adi will know how to answer this. Adi didn't know how to answer. So he interrupted Baba's seclusion.
Oh.
Yes. Because Baba, I just don't know. And so that sparked a 2.5-page letter back to me, dictated by Baba, explaining in a very, very gentle and kind way that there wasn't any chance that I had even hit the shadow of the first subtle plane. And went on a whole list of reasons why you could make no spiritual progress with these drugs. So that put a different light on things. Now, the topper was, I go back and say, well, how come they recognize me as being a saint or something like that? And then I realized first that yes, I was shining like a god. I had stayed in the hot sun for 8 hours. And honestly, with no sunscreen. So I was bright red. I was probably glowing. Then I went back to the hospital and tried to find out from the kids what was going on. And what had happened was the first two kids said, there's Paul McCartney. So that was the ultimate validation. And they didn't hear about what was right. But it took, and then, of course, Rick and Robert, and they've been writing their memoirs, we started to get a little group that also was not satisfied with the Gurdjieff techniques, which is basically one form of maybe the 90 forms of meditation that Baba outlines. It's basically a self-observation, detachment, dissociative meditation technique that if you're lucky, after a lifetime, you would be able to observe your body and know that you're a robot. Well, Baba pointed that out much more quickly. You don't even exist, really. It was much better about it. So, at that time I still didn't know what Meher Baba's method was. You know, we had been very, very technique-oriented. And gurus were popping up, giving experiences, giving all kinds of fancy meditations. Didn't quite get it. Took me 6 months. I went out to visit Ram Dass and Murshida Ivy Deuce and Don Stevens and Lud Dimple, who were the only people I knew in the country that knew anything about Meher Baba. And they assured me there was a technique, and I would figure it out sooner or later. So scientifically, I decided, all right, I know the drugs are not working. I know that your juice is not working. I'll do Meher Baba for 6 months and cut out the other things and as a true experiment and see if it works. It worked pretty good. Pretty good. And that really then set the stage for a remarkable series of adventures, which I'll talk about tomorrow morning, in which Baba really engaged, and many of you were involved too, his lovers around the world, particularly in the West, to really get active about bringing the truth about drugs and getting people to take the next step. And then it turned out, of course, he was very sneaky about it because it was a way to get his name out. And that happened today in the interview. Even though it was on, technical drug stuff and marijuana and THC and legalization, etc. It's always a way to work in. Yeah, there's a great psychologist in India who was really on top of this 50 years ago. Who predicted all the research that was going on. Anyway, so this is a little taste and flavor of what it was like back in those early days in Boston. And tomorrow I'll share what happened when Baba started to push the button. It got even wilder. Much wilder. Much wilder. So let's see. Is there anything you want to hear more about that I'm not saving? Or give me issues that are of great interest for the rest of the weekend. Yes.
Just before, for a minute, does anybody think those photos? move around a little bit.
Yeah, informal is means.
You know, just feel free to.
Feel free to do anything. Yes. I mean, this is Australia. Yes, sir.
I remember reading The Center of the Cyclone in about 74, I guess. I've always thought there was a Cohen mentioned in that.
Well, this does bring up a story, actually. There was an Alan Cohen who was the editor of the Oracle magazine in San Francisco. Oracle magazine was the newspaper of the hip movement. And they were pretty pro-LSD. And he got a lot of publicity, enough so that my hometown newspaper had to issue correction. The Alan Cohen at Life magazine is not our Alan Cohen. People are coming into my place, oh, you poor thing. I won't strap it, beard, hip, and take a drug. So they arranged, we arranged a debate between Alan Cohen and Alan Cohen at the Steppenwolf Cafe in Berkeley.
So that's the one that Rick Albert mentions in the book? Or is there no mention of an Alan Cohen in Rick Albert's, Rich Albert's Center of the Cyclone? Do you know?
It could have also been Sidney Cohen. Sidney was a psychiatrist who had run the national, what would now be the National Institute on Drug Abuse. But he was a cool guy. And so they would go back and forth. Sidney Cohen would write a book against drugs, and at that time Alpert would reply, but they both liked each other, so it might have been.
Right.
I've been able to stay out of most of those books, thankfully. Back here, yeah.
Test and you had to survive for 12 hours.
Yes.
How did they know if you survived mentally? Was there like a random yes, no?
Oh, no. You know, you can tell. You can tell if somebody's going bonkers pretty easily when you see them after that kind of test. If you failed, you wouldn't be functional. You might have run away. You would be terrorized slightly. Yes, that would have been, that's the first question. You say yes. The second question is that really important in spirituality? And then that's a no. That's a no. Go ahead. No, Gurdjieff never came to the United States, as far as I know. One of his disciples was in London for a long time. His name was Uspensky. And there were different lineages of Gurdjieff students. He clearly, he was kind of one of these, what we, the Baba people call Jalali teachers. He'd get his students drunk on Armagnac and kick them around. And the whole notion was that human beings couldn't control themselves. And that the body kind of, and the mind and the emotions operated automatically and without consciousness. And the job was for the student to observe this and to have a chance of running the machine, which is the body. But in the old days we did, I got to interview a lot of the gurus of the time and ask them test questions, you know, with firmed up with the knowledge from Baba. Ask him about reincarnation, etc. Generally see what was going on. Now, one of the big things is whether the gurus gave people experiences. People really like experiences. And what's his name? Muktananda. Now there is a very story about Muktananda. Muktananda had a very large following. He was kind of a young emigre from Tibet. And was more in the yogic Tibetan tradition than in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition. He had a big group in Berkeley and Oakland, and you'd kind of pass by him, and he'd give you an experience. So, of course, Mayor Baba didn't think very much of that. But I found out last year, I was at Mayor Mount in Ojai, and it was getting to be around Baba's birthday. And they were, it just happened. And they were arranging a kind of a birthday celebration at Mayor Mount. And then somebody came up and said, there's already a Mayor Baba's celebration going with about, 60 people in Ojai. And the heads of Marymount had no knowledge of it. They knew everybody in Ojai. How could there be a party for Mayor Baba? It turned out to be the Swami Muktananda people. Because just before he died, Muktananda said to his disciples, Mayor Baba is exactly who he says he is. And they come to Marymount every year on their way to visit their own center. They stay for a day. It's very interesting.
Did you say they come to Marabout?
Yes. Yeah.
What day is that?
Huh?
What day
do they?
You got Puna that day.
No, I think his mother took over the order. Now there was a split in the family. I mean, it always happens. The gurus who really are not gurus, and they always get in trouble. It's either sex, usually, or money, with a little power sprinkled in. And giving guruship a bad name in the old days. Now, incredibly, the word guru is in the vocabulary. The word avatar is in the vocabulary. There was even a television show with karma in its name in the U.S. And so what used to be very, very strange in concepts of Eastern spirituality have now moved in to the language. And we're certainly seeing a surge of, for example, television shows about people having died and come back. There's a lot of medium shows on. Among a broad network of people in America, everyone has their own pet animal psychic that is consulted. So there's half the people I know, either Bible lovers or non-Bible lovers, when they're having trouble with their pets, they call up the psychic. David's shaking his head. You have a misbehaving cat or dog, and you see. And it's very, one of them is the sister of a longtime Baba lover, and she's what we would call a Baba liker. Emergency room nurse by day, rides a Harley motorcycle at night, and is completely telepathic with animals and can talk with them. I don't know what language they use when they talk, but they can do it from a distance, and you get amazing insights about what the animals are thinking. Anyway, it's not that people that used to seem kind of crazy. But I'm saying now, you bring that up and they say, well, my pet psychic's probably better. Or, I know one who's better for medical conditions. And somebody says, well, I know one who's really good for for psychological stuff and behavior modification. So a lot of the transition, and I haven't told you all the stories about the occult things, but I will tell a few things tomorrow. But the whole transition from interest in parapsychology and mediumship and the occult stuff has, in a sense, been a bridge to make both the notion of reincarnation seem much more reasonable to the vast majority of people. The notion of karma has eked its way in so much that people will tell you, I didn't want to do this because I didn't want to create bad karma. And these are not necessarily spiritual students. This is the average Joe. Later, I think on Sunday, we'll talk about what Baba might be doing on a macro level with the entire earth and the population. And why this group here, which I would say over 50% are on higher planes of consciousness. But Baba veils everybody, almost everybody. And there are good reasons for that, which we will go into. But that has to be respected. I understand that whenever I talk to you like this. You can't have it. You know how many Baba lovers are in the world compared to the world population? Decimal dust. That's right. You'd think the Avatar would be more popular. And eventually you'll be overrun here too. But the important thing is that why us? I mean, if you took a survey of all of our lives together, sainthood would not be conferred.
That's true.
And on Sunday, we will talk about what occurs psychologically when samskaras get burned, and how Baba has promised that we will get to face the absolute worst, most animalistic samskaras that we've built up over eons of time of winding samskaras, and how in this time it's such a wonderful opportunity. And we'll talk about specifically anxiety and depression, which are almost absolutely necessary experiences that people have to go through if they're spiritual students. But for mystical reasons, not to gain your certificate, do I have my quota of suffering this year?
Definitely.
And also, the wonderful thing about Baba setting up interpersonal relationships, which are guaranteed to be, somebody told me the Australian term, grizzly, is that a correct term? And that this is the time to work out the most difficult relationships. And it's almost, Baba said, it's almost impossible to really collaborate in harmony, because you're with a set of people that the dynamics are very strong. It can be very unusual. You've been with this wave of people before, and stuff is still being worked out. But the ability of groups like this to harmonize, I know you don't think it's 100% harmonious, but compared to the ordinary world, this is mellow. And you're not even conscious of your higher planes. That's even wilder. So we'll talk a little bit about how, what it means for individuals to be role models or templates on the samskaric and the subtle and mental level. That's really very, very helpful and necessary for the entire world. And the fact that you're not here coincidentally. And even though, I must say, among Baba lovers in the United States at least, low self-esteem is right up there. And the difference between expectations in reality is very, very high. But all of this, I'm going to argue, all of this is really good. Really good. Trouble is good. May or may not will stir up trouble if you're getting bored. And you'll take it out. You'll feel it in your bodies and your emotions, and occasionally a mind that begins to drop off. So the tension, and we'll talk about this too, there's a unique tension of Meher Baba Western spirituality that calls for fantastically more skill in living than the good old days where you escaped from the Kali Yuga by going in caves. You did your householding things and went off into the jungle. And you could meditate all the time. Different ball game now. Very different ball game. Harder ball game. Merging both the internal spiritual development towards Baba and still paying attention to the details of ordinary life, which he was very, very big on. Remind me, I want just to read you something at the end. So it's really kind of remarkable about how this, the limited number of Baba lovers have been able to have an influence, either directly or indirectly, over whole continents. And Baba wanting his name to be known, not necessarily to draw new recruits, but to change consciousness of the populations on the earth. So we're gonna touch on that a little bit this weekend, because that's really fun. And the psychology is really fun. And the controversies, which we'll go into in the Meher Baba world, are also a lot of fun. And I never believed that Meher Baba's laid out everything so comprehensively and clearly in English, in no translation. How could you screw this up? How could the theologist screw it up and make it, you know? No, Baba said to do this. Well, on page so-and-so, he said to do this, and then somebody else. So I think collective egos will try in the future, have their little niches of ideological preference as to what Baba really said to do. Mm. And it's hard for us, very hard for us to get out of that, because Baba doesn't. He's not like a teacher and you're being graded. We are all part of him moving in a positive direction and inevitably moving forward and inevitably learning only by mistakes. Only by mistakes. Because if you're just grooving there, you don't learn nothing. So.
My name's Ivan. How are you?
Hi, good.
Biggest survivor of the 60s.
Excuse me, Ivan.
Would you agree with the notion that the drugs at the time speeded up something inside of us, opened up a certain consciousness which otherwise we would not have experienced? And a lot of the so-called gurus that you sort of mentioned, yes. So-called, were that sort of part of Baba's work in order to guide us to him?
What a good question. So the answer might be on two different levels. On one level, Baba said that for a select few people, drug experiences has been a way that they've come to learn about me, but after that it has no value. From a cultural point of view, you can argue that the explosion of this kind of stuff, like in the 60s and the 70s, started to lay the foundation for the appreciation of the West for Eastern thinking. it wasn't a very sophisticated understanding, but it was important. And the fact that there's even the notion of gurus, there's notions of spiritual students in all the traditions. And let me talk about this also when we can. There are radical reformations occurring in the major religions and secular societies towards, much more towards what Baba's trying to do. Now, on the third level, almost everything is Baba's work. And you can look back at anything and say, you know, it was probably necessary. The analogy I like to use is, it's true that people who went off to war in Vietnam or Afghanistan, some of them came back as much more mature people, much more solid, deeper appreciation of life. But you wouldn't necessarily generalize and say, then go out, join the army and kill some people. You're going to have for a spiritual revelation. So I think it's the issue of the few. And the fact that you're a survivor and you're here says that that was meant to be. But you wouldn't do it for your children. You'd say, well, I got here that way. Yeah, why don't you try, you know? That wouldn't be it.
Sometimes it's the 60s that sometimes refer to the golden age of Maya Baba, because of course we all know that Baba had turned the key in the 60s.
Yes.
And there seemed to be a real energy there.
Very zippy energy at that time.
Will that happen again? Do you think that will happen again?
Things tend to happen in waves. It wouldn't surprise me, although this seems to be a period of consolidation, of maturity, of Baba really getting rooted among his lovers and being able kind of to introduce him when necessary to other people. And as you know, Mayor Baba really doesn't discriminate against loving spiritual people of any tradition, and has often sent people back, both to their religious systems and to their other gurus. The trick about Baba is that all individual evolution really is personalized, and it's very difficult to extract rigid principles that would apply to all Baba lovers. He has a few, but not that many, because the goal is always the same, but the path is very, very different. And I have, over the years in correspondence, witnessed Meher Baba telling people the exact opposite of what he's told others on some very sensitive issues. Very sensitive. I won't even mention them. Well, I will. Like the issue of abortion, for example. You know, you expect to have that religions and religious figures have positions. This is good or this is bad. And it don't work that way from the advertiser's point of view. So, it was a very, very interesting time, and he really put the accelerator, really. And I'll talk about that tomorrow morning, about some of the things that happened, yes.
I was going to ask you if you were going to talk from your work as a psychologist.
Yes.
And I think you've counseled a lot of Baba people as well from what I've
heard. Yes.
So, but do you think that the things that you've already mentioned, you'll cover the issues, because
yeah.
I know that one sees the same stories coming up. Are you going to be talking about subjects that you've already mentioned?
Yes.
Or can you do something extra on top? I mean, I'm just curious about
we're going to have a whole section on psychological elements. And that will include family life and what Western culture is kind of up to, and what Bob has kind of predicted and laid out. And if it doesn't get covered, you yell at me, okay? We have left
that.
I was just going to make a comment, and I think Bill and Diana had backed me up on this. When you see the young people at the Sahavas, the changes and that wave of energy that's coming, and it's not so much coming from the people, but it's coming from the internet, and it's coming from all over, and there's this huge numbers of young people all over the world who talk to each other on a daily basis. So there is a different type of wave, I think, coming, but not the same wave that was seen in the 60s. That was all.
Yeah, I mean, that's... it's happening on the internet as well. Well, there's something special. Baba said that on different occasions, when his lovers get together, in his name, something special happens. And that's kind of, partially that's kind of one of the softens, like this is so important. The force that comes from us being together is multiplied 10-100 times. And really, and we'll talk about this too as we can, the individual Baba people are channels of high divine energy. Now, you don't feel that. I don't feel that. But it happens. And so everybody's kind of an agent of the new humanity, whether they think of it, you know, obviously or not obviously. So I think there'll always be a place for individual groups. Mm-hmm. And there'll always be a place for the loners. I mean, it's thought that half of all about lovers never go to a group.
That's true.
And they might have been scared away. Because what do they imagine? You know, what do they imagine? All these little saints, you know, that are non-energetic or will try to cross or tie to you. But it's very, very powerful. And I think probably those links are laid on the internet as well. And there's energy there. So this is a very important group of people here. I bow down. And you've already done a lot. So I'm going to end with just a quote from, to come back to the Baba's wish. He talked about Baba's will in terms of what he works out, but this is his encouragement. Number one, do not shirk your responsibilities. And we'll talk about that this weekend. A number one wish? I mean, where's the cave? What about the old days? You just spent all your time in prayer and meditation. Attend faithfully to your worldly duties, but always keep at the back of your mind that all this is Baba. So this weekend I will also suggest a very hidden part of Baba's techniques about how to make it in the world and still keep in mind that it's his. And then he says, when you feel happy, think, Baba wants number three. Baba wants me to be happy. When you suffer, think, Baba wants me to suffer. Baba wants me to suffer? Why would he want that? There's very good mystical reasons for that. Number four, be resigned to every situation and think honestly and sincerely, Baba has placed me in this situation. So we're not used to the thought that everything is not random. It's not random. That is, it's hard to imagine that in ordinary life, you are in situations that Baba has set up for a particular reason, either for your learning or for somebody else. Number five, this is very big, with the understanding that Baba is in everyone trying to help and serve others. Again, there is a deeply mystical reason for this. This is not, and we will discuss that this weekend. Also, this ain't just be good, and God will smile upon you, and your between life experiences will be much more pleasant. This really has all to do with the destruction of the ego. And then, number six, which certainly Francis Brown is on, would take the theme poetically and run with it wonderfully. Baba says, I say with my divine authority to each and all that whomsoever takes my name at the time of breathing his last comes to me. So do not forget to remember me in your last moment. Unless you start remembering me from now on, it'll be difficult to remember me when your end approaches. You should start practicing. Even if you take my name only once every day, you will not forget to remember me in your dying moments. Mirabab was using a little psychology here as well as total profundity of being God. That is, the ego doesn't really want to die. And so he kind of saying if you, he understands that and it would be a good thing to remember him at the end. It's kind of like waking up from the dream. So we'll also, I think tomorrow night, go into the core of what Mirabab is all about, which is much simpler than people make it up. Not complicated. In fact, now we have reached a period in history where I do not think it's possible for a person following Baba to read all the books, see all the videos, listen to all the music, and read everybody's blog. There are too many hours now. The information overload. Now, some of you can do that if you worked your way up through everything. Stuff is coming out so fast now about Bob, about people's recognitions, about creative stuff, about special seminars and special workshops. The material is gigantic. So at some point, we have to understand that we're not going to be able to remember everything that Baba has said about everything, or that everybody has reacted to it. But that's okay. It will